as far as this session, I mean, actually, what I wanted to interact, that there are three things we come down to this forward, carry, carry. Aage a jao, aage a jao. Now there are three things I say. First is that sociology questions are not unexpected. They are very expected questions. Set of questions only in the second paper, sometime, if they are pleased, they give some new social issue questions. First is expected questions. They don't have many new questions. The second thing is that in the second paper, the paper is somewhat open. Although expected, but it is open in the sense that they do not have the things in the syllabus. Nowhere Gandhi is mentioned, nowhere Ambedkar is mentioned, nowhere Phule is mentioned, but they give questions on Phule, Gandhi, Ambedkar. In the same manner, they have not said that they'll ask questions on social issues. But every year, either one or two questions are there from the social issue. What are the social issues? Social issues are of two types. One, those social problems which are debated at the present time. Dalit is now debated, women is now debated. So in the same manner, some of the LGBTs are being debated, transgenders are being debated, Article 377 is being debated. So these are the issues. A second thing is, just another aspect of this, that you may get questions on those legislations which have been recently passed, Child Labour Act, Forest Right Act, these things. As far as the third thing is concerned, generally there is a tendency on your part that you try to write common sense in sociology. I don't do this. Sociology is a very accurate sense. Sociology can never be common sense. In first paper, sometime there is a note, sociology and common sense. Write and comment that sociology has nothing to do with common sense. There are two sociologists, one from England, Norman Bauer. He discussed that sociology has Bauer. Sociology has nothing to do with it doesn't have anything to do with common sense. In India, there is a very popular sociologist. If we call him the second generation sociologist, we may call him, he is Andre Bethe, not Bitai or something like that, Andre Bethe. Any discussion of Indian sociology will not be complete without a reference to Bethe. His works are good on caste, works are good on class, and works are also good on modernization. social changes and these social transformations in India.
What Bethe said?
Bethe's essays, he has written numerous essays, a prolific writer that way. Dipankar Gupta, probably you know his name. Dipankar Gupta or Dipankar Gupta. Yeah, social certification. So, Dipankar Gupta edited a book, Utopia. This book is a collection of Bethe's essays, all essays. One essay is on common sense, and what Bethe writes that this common sense has no relationship with sociology. I was saying that you write common sense, don't write common sense, write very to the point and also write enrichment of the question. There should be three things if you remember. Number one is the man who has made a study, Srinivas, Mysore, Narasimha Char Srinivas studied Ramapura village. Yes. Our this man Bethe, he studied Tanjore district, Tamil Nadu, Sripuram village. So you can quote them exactly that he had studied this and he has said this. The second thing is that some of the scholars or sociologists who are giants in any field, you refer to them. You refer to Weber, you refer to Parsons, you refer to Blauner, you refer to this Hoffman. So these are the important sociologists, you give references. And the third thing is that you give examples. This is what makes your answer very strong and very rich. This is the thing which makes it very rich and strong. In fact, when we just say one thing, many times you get a reference or a guidance or a rider in your paper, write in the sociological perspective. This is the beginning. So whenever we write that what is sociology, you can say it is the study of social fact, nothing else. This is the common thing. Now this has become universal. Sociology is the study of social fact. Sociology, this is a statement of Emil Durkheim. Clear? No other conception. But when we talk of the perspective of sociology, what is this perspective? Whenever sociology is discussing anything, trying to study anything, it has five concerns, five chinta, five aspects, five dimensions. Number one is this social fact itself. Write in your copies that social fact is anything which is related to a group of two persons. You two are maybe friends. If you are a friend, then it is a social fact. But no individual, no individual phenomena is a social fact. Anything that is anything that is of a group, anything that is of a society that has a relevance to group, then it becomes social fact. Social fact has two things. Number one, how it is constituted, of what it is made. So there are two things. Not consensus. In sociology, we are very difficultly find anything which is consensual. They are not actually based on consensus. They are based on two things. One is that they have the majority support, and the second thing is that they have the support of the powerful. Sociology is a rogue science. It is a bad science. It is a very, very criminal science. Why? It's not at all concerned what is good, what is appropriate. It is concerned with what is the real thing, that reality is there. So I said that as far as this components are concerned, there is collective consciousness. So when we say consensus, that means all are accepting it. When we say consciousness, then we mean that you accept. Not all, but those which are related to the group. They are just doing this. They are this. This collective consciousness is there. Acceptance is there. The second thing is that as far as social fact is there, it is shared. Consciousness and shared means followed. You do not only know it, rather you two are friends. Other people know that you two are friends. You are conscious that he is friend of mine, and he is conscious that you are friend of him. Now this acceptance has other part, that you share the responsibility of being a friend. That is called sharing. It has got two features. Those features are, one is this, what are those features? One is the constraint. One is the constraint. That means you have to, this is a wrong word, constraint. You are influenced by it. Simply, you are influenced by it. The second thing is that Durkheim said that this is external. Very often we are confused. What do we mean by external? That means even if we want, we cannot do something all on our own. Supposing you two are friends, and you say one morning, no, I will not remain your friend. This is not done. Unless and until there is a conflict, unless and until there is some kind of disagreement, only then you say, slowly we will cease to be friends. Now, as far as this first part, whenever there is question on sociological perspective, you have to take into consideration that this is something related to a social fact. Clear? The second thing is that we accept in sociology that the major structures, economy, polity, religion, they influence our lives. We are not independent. We have to follow these things. We have to follow religion, whatever is the religion. We have to follow the economy. We have to follow that politics. So if the IAS recruitment laws are changed, then you will have to change. The lateral entries are there. The students are very much angry. Why this lateral entry or recruitment in the IAS cadre? So naturally, this is the influence. Who said this? There was an American sociologist, probably you have heard his name, C. Wright Mills. Have you heard? What is his basic concept? Power. Power elite. Power elite. Power elite. So naturally, he is the man. Earlier he was not given that much importance. But in current sociology, after the 90s, he has become very important. The third thing is society. Some or other sociologist is there, Howard Baker. Anything we say, anything we do, everybody who is living in India, he has to have some consideration of Indian situation. He's a Muslim, he's a Sikh, he's a Parsi, he's a Dalit, he's a Brahmin, anybody. He's a Kerala, Kashmir, Jammu Kashmir. He has some context of the society of India. So, this was said by Howard Baker, probably again an American sociologist, but he said very emphatically that this is a very essential thing. You will say, sir, when we just have the sociological perspective, how we write everything? No, no. You simply have to keep in your mind the social fact, the major social structure. Number three, this society's context. Number four is social behavior. Probably you have heard also his name, Simmel, George Simmel, a German sociologist, man of social action, a friend of Max Weber, a friend of Ferdinand Tonnies, a friend of this Mises. All these people were contemporaries. They all together formed the German Sociological Society in 1910. Simmel said that behavior is important. Supposing you two are friends, but you do not maintain any contact with each other, then what would happen? Your relationship would be there. It would not be there. So behavior and action is necessary for maintaining the relationship. Clear? Any doubt? And then there is a fourth thing. It is said social concern, samajik chinta. Social concern, there is a lady or anybody, Martha Nussbaum. What is said? Martha Nussbaum said that sociology from its beginning has social concern. It has social concern from the beginning. Social concern means why? Why? August Comte conceived about sociology. What was the reason? He wanted that this industrial society has produced many problems. Those problems must be solved. who can solve or which can solve? It is sociology which can solve the problems. So naturally, this is the perspective of sociology. In any question, you keep in your mind these five things. You have to have some concern of the social fact. You have to have some concern of the macro, large structures, economy, politics, this religion, this family, kinship, the place you live in. So those are important things. Naturally, when we talk of this society, I have told you, no matter whoever he is, Indian society has a concern. Then is this social action. Weber was always saying that social action is more important. Simmel was also always saying social is more important. Why they said it? Some people objected to it. Mills objected, but his objection is wrong. Social action is necessary for maintaining relations, for maintaining any structures. If this is not done, then this would fail. The next is Martha Nussbaum. How long you will continue to write about Marx, Pareto, Weber? Come down to these modern sociologists. She is alive, not very old, not more than 50 years, and she has rightly written that if today there is globalization and globalization is producing human machines, people are running after the corporate jobs. This society is not heading towards a healthy social goals. We must criticize. She said it. So naturally, this is what is the social concern. Now, as far as this is the general thing we said, now come down to the first paper. The syllabus is somewhat very, very true as far as the first paper is concerned. We start with social stratification.
Any questions?
I am just... actually, today's topic was social stratification, that's why. But what I say, that in social stratification, there are only five things you have to study. Number one is the theoretical aspects, theory. Only three persons are concerned, rather four persons, because Davis and Moore are two friends. Davis and Moore, now both of them are dead. Then is Marx, and then is Weber. So very often we take these people as we know. Read very carefully. As far as Davis is concerned and Moore are concerned, their basic focus is that society has a mechanism to select the best persons for different jobs. One person is good for administration, he is selected. One person is good for farming, he is given that job. The second aspect is, as the job requires skill and sacrifice, the more skill is needed, the more sacrifice is needed, the more rewards are there. This is the basic. As far as Marx is concerned, Marx said, in the social division, the most important thing is the relationship of production. Your popular question is mode of production. Mode of production has two aspects. One is forces of production, another is relations of production. What he says that it is the control over resources which makes people powerful. On the other hand, what Weber says, no. It is not economic resource. He criticized Marx. They didn't have any interaction. Although when Weber died, or when Weber was writing, Marx was alive. So, naturally, what we say that they didn't have, or neither they could have met. But Weber said that in his time, two scholars are most important scholars. One is Friedrich Nietzsche. You are not concerned with Nietzsche, but remember, without Nietzsche, you cannot discuss Weber. What Weber says, power is the central thing. If you have power, you can have prestige, you can have money. Simply you will beat person that I give me the money. This is what the conception of Weber is. Weber is not less important than Marx. So, this is one aspect where from questions are there. The second in this is the dimensions. Dimensions mean,
You mentioned Nietzsche. How Nietzsche is related to Weber? Nietzsche.
This Nietzsche. Arey Baba, it was he who said power is the most important element. It was he. The man, the concept of Superman, it is his concept, Nietzsche's concept. A person who has the power, a group who has the power, it can have any and everything. So this Nietzsche, Friedrich Nietzsche, a German scholar. So there are two persons. One is Kant, whose basic principles Weber follows, and the other is Nietzsche, whose arguments he has accepted in sociology. It was Nietzsche who said, power is everything. Weber also says, power is everything. Power is, economy is an appendage of power, and prestige is an appendage of power. It does not have an autonomous existence. He criticized Marx as economic determinist. Clear? Now, as far as the dimensions are concerned, so these dimensions, or the forms where this stratification works, they have not mentioned caste. I just ask you or appeal you to study caste. Because in the first paper also, you will have a question on caste. Today probably if you have appeared in the exam, we have given that question on caste and class. In India, any discussion of this social division cannot be complete without a discussion of caste. It is so pervasive, it is so powerful that it has an influence on the social life of people. So the second is class, the third is status, the fourth is race, the fifth is ethnicity, and then it is gender. So remember that from every aspect Last year they gave the question on race, ethnicity and gender. In one question, all the things were asked. So naturally you know gender, be very specific about your conception of gender. That means you have gender does not mean male and female. This gender, according to a lady sociologist of America, who said gender is only reserved for women, not male. Analyst. So she said that gender means weak females, nothing else. From 1983, the World Bank took it. The United Nations Development Program took it that gender means weak and female, woman. So naturally, as far as this third aspect is concerned in this social stratification, there are certain conceptual questions. What? Number one, there is equality. Nehru once said, the spirit of the age is equality. The reality of the age is inequality. What does it mean? People, Nehru said it much earlier in 1956 when the Awadhi session of the Congress Party was held and the socialist construction and program was being planned at that time. So he said this is then equality, everybody is talking in you, but inequality is very much popular. So you have to discuss equality, you have to discuss inequality, you have to discuss deprivation, you have to discuss poverty, you have to discuss hierarchy. So write in your copies, whenever you are discussing poverty, Peter Saunders must be referred, a British sociologist, now dead, he must be. There are probably more than 50 studies in England about this poverty. He is the man who gave the concept of relative poverty and absolute poverty. He is the man who took and who said that poverty must be seen as relative deprivation. It is a relative deprivation, it is not absolute deprivation. He was the man who discussed it. So then these questions, as far as this inequality is concerned, our Bethe Sahib says, probably you have heard the name of De Tocqueville. Anybody? Tocqueville.
Yeah.
French, who wrote about American democracy. This man Bethe says that he was an important sociologist, and he has written a chapter on Tocqueville. Now, he also said inequality is normal, regular. No matter what you do, there will be inequality. There will be inequality. So, Bethe also says there will be inequality. Whenever, probably in 2014, there was a note on social inequality. Refer to Bethe, refer to De Tocqueville, refer to Parsons. Parsons also says, inequality is normal, equality is exception. Clear? So now as far as only one thing, that is social mobility, that is also an important aspect. In social mobility, in India we didn't have such studies, but you must refer to two studies. One, Oxford, and another is Cambridge. But you should refer, you begin with a reference to D.V. Glass. Why? D.V. Glass is the man in England who started this discussion of social. The concept has been given by P.A. Sorokin. 1927 is the year in which Sorokin wrote a small book, Social Mobility. He is the father of the concept of social, but he did not study it. R.K. Merton was a student of Sorokin. Merton advised his guru that no need, because there is much of social mobility in America, there is no need to study it. And Sorokin was a very cynical man. He always thought, I am the best sociologist of the world. He always said that, I am the best. He was very laborious. The amount of writing he has produced, enormous. Throughout our life, we have not been able to, we have read everything what Merton has said, written, and whatever a Parsons has written, but not what Sorokin has written. Enormous, voluminous writings, sociocultural dynamics, 1100 pages, in every volume of the four volumes. So that is something very typical of. Now, as far as social mobility is concerned, whenever you are discussing social mobility in the first paper, give a reference to the concept of Sanskritization and Western. Sanskritization and Westernization must be mentioned as two forms of social mobility in India, two forms of social mobility in India, you have to refer to it. This is clear? Now, there is a topic, in fact, it was Herlambos who first called economy as the organization of work. There would be a question from that. There are four aspects. This organization of work has four questions, four aspects which are very important. One is the work organization in four societies: slave, feudal, capitalist, and global. These are the four societies in which the work organization is asked. These are the questions on which. So we'll just tell you what this means. Simply, how production is done and what is the relationship between the master of the production and the worker of the production. That is only the work organization. The second thing in this is the informal and formal work and formal sectors. The third is the labor status or labor position. What is the condition of the working class. What is the condition? So there was a question. Deterritorialization because of globalization. I don't know, very often students complain that no sir, we could not understand the question. This simply means that in the globalization period, working class cannot remain in one place in large numbers because the technology has improved and there are no large factories, small production concerns. That is what the condition. And the fourth thing is that as far as the, it's very rare, but sometime they may ask the trade unions or the position of the trade unions. Clear? Now, as far as the next is concerned, that is politics. In the first paper, politics is a very popular topic. And there are seven aspects from which questions are asked. Number one is this question, nation and state. The second is must be very clear as to what a nation is. You should be very clear because if you are not clear, then there will be problems. The second aspect is democracy. The third aspect is civil society. In your own discussions, you write about civil society because very often you are not very clear what civil society is. Generally, people say all the NGOs are civil society. No, only those NGOs which are working for individual rights, who are working for the protection of democracy. For example, combat against corruption. This Kejriwal's earlier organization is part of the civil society. But Dhan, which is working for agriculture, that is not a civil society. The NGO working for the protection of the animals, that is not a civil society. Clear? So, the fourth thing is that as far as this politics is concerned, the power theory, only three things. Power theory has, number one, zero sum means very more simpler, that supposing we have 10 is the amount. India has 10 power. So unless and until the other loses power, Indian power will not go up. It remains constant. So in a community, power is 15. So this is distributed. Somebody is having somebody 4, somebody 5, somebody 6. So unless and until there is a change, there cannot be increase and there can be decrease. This is zero sum. The criticism is this social power. This is Weber and this is Parsons. Social power is diametrically opposed to zero sum concept. The third thing is that we have already referred to that power elite. We have already referred to is the power elite. Naturally, as far as this power elite is concerned, this is a concept of Mills. Elite is a very popular concept. In sociology, the discussion of elite was started by Gaetano Mosca. Somehow or other, it is an Italian intellectual scene. You have heard about Machiavelli, the prince who wrote The Prince. Italians always say power is held by a small group. They are right. So elite, the very word elite, is an Italian word. And this man, there are numerous persons, Floyd, Hunter and others, who have discussed. The next is, fifth is the political parties, a very regular question. Political parties and pressure groups. The sixth is this collective action, write in your copies, and social movement. And the seventh, social revolution. Remember 2016 question, social revolution dislocates everything. Social movement does not do it. So the aspect of politics is very large, and you have to write about different scholars, modern commentators, even write about Indian sociologists. Write about, there is Satish Mishra. He is a sociologist. Delhi School of Economics, sociologist. Now, these people, or even Surinder Jodhka, a current sociologist, quote him. He has studied two Haryana villages, teaches in probably, I don't know if he is there or not, or he has left or retired. So that was there, or that is there. He also talked about power. In any question, you try to give Indian examples, correct. Indian references, correct. So there is then the question of religion. You definitely have a question on religion. So as far as religion is concerned, there is a central figure in religion, and that figure is, who is that figure? It is Durkheim, Emil Durkheim. You will have a question on this man, Durkheim. He is with it. I pronounce him Durkheim because he is not Durkheim, Durkheim. In religion, he would be a question. Every time, directly, indirectly, Durkheim would be asked. That's the reason I just am discussing this, that he will be asked. Then, as far as this Durkheim is concerned, you try to go for his theory. That theory has, or that conceptualization has, three dimensions. What are those dimensions? One is the concept of sacred and profane. Don't be confused that profane means bad. You write about this. No. Profane means useful but not religious. Second thing is, you remember about totem. Totemism or totem. Actually, this is important, because the whole theory of Durkheim rests on the concept of totem. Durkheim does not say that totem is important in its own self. No. Totem is important because it represents group. religion is nothing but it is the worship of society, it is the worship of the group. Religion is nothing but it is the worship of the group, it is the worship of society. Clear? Now, as far as this religion is concerned, I said about this Durkheim, three parts. Number one is sacred and profane. Number two is the theory or the totem theory. Number three, what has happened in religion today. Durkheim has been very much praised in India. T.N. Madan, he is a very important sociologist of India. Trilokinath Madan, an expert on two things. On the one hand, on family, he studied the Kashmiri Pandit families, Kashmir. The second is his study of Indian religions. He has very serious, he is the man who for the first time wrote about Indic religions and non-Indic, Indian religions and not in non-Indian religions. That you have to study. Now, as far as religion is concerned, then there would be a comparison between, remember this, religion and science. Probably you have, you know that question, that science has logical means for logical ends, and religion has illogical means for logical ends. Even religion is directed towards finding certain answers, finding certain solutions. This is, so you have to remember, nowhere it is mentioned that religion and science comparison would be there. But the trend of question says that this is a particular popular question. You have to remember it. Now, in religion, there are four things we discuss. One is secularism, another is communalism, another is fundamentalism, and another is revivalism. Last year the question was, do you think revivalism is communalism? This was the question. Communalism and revivalism are very different. India is not a communal society, but India which witnessed to religious revivalism. Every religion has become important today. This is revivalism. Clear? Now, as far as the first paper is concerned, in the first paper, we'll have to discuss this kinship. There are three, in religion there is one more I just forgot to mention, this sect and cult. These are two groupings, not groupings as such, that you have to distinguish. Very often we do not know it. What has happened that Max Weber and his friend Ernest Troels, he is the man who has discussed all these things. All people who believe in one religion is called as denomination. All Hindus, all Muslims, all Christians, denomination. Then those who have defined religious places within the same religion, the Shaivites, Shiv Mandir is a different thing, the Krishna Mandir is a different thing. The Shia and the Sunni, they are different things. That is the sect. And then in some religions, there are particular groups, sometimes related to a person, related to a saint, sometimes related to a particular worship style. So, as far as the Shaivites are concerned, the Shaivites are divided into 12 branches. The Gorakhpanthis. So, why there are these Badrinath, Kedarnath, Vaidyanath, Gorakhnath? You know, when the Karnataka elections were there, one group became very prominent. They constitute 13% of the Karnataka population, and Yadurappa belongs to that group. What is that group?
Lingayats.
What is Lingayat? Yeah, that's true. It is a cult. It's a cult. Within Shaivism, this man is Basava is there. So this is a person with around whom Basava was not literate, but he was a great person in the sense that his philosophy is very radical. If within the Shaivite denomination, Basava's this cult is very, very radical. So naturally, this is an example of the cult. It'll have to be right. In kinship and family, there are four questions. Actually, Malinowski is Malinowski. Yes. Brown is not an expert on religion, and he has not discussed any religion as such. Radcliffe Brown and Malinowski are anthropologists. They are not sociologists. It is true that when Parsons went to England, he stayed with Malinowski. And it was because of this common living for some time that Parsons has tried to follow. Parsons was not a student of sociology when he went to England. He was a student of economics. He was pursuing his PhDs, wanting to submit his PhD. But he was so much influenced by these people, these sociologists, that he became a sociologist. Malinowski has discussed about religion. But as far as his discussion is concerned, that is more related to primitive societies. The Melanesians, off coast Australia people who live there and who follow a particular life, they have been discussed. So the concept of religion is not the concern of Malinowski. Malinowski is a great man. His commitment to participant observation is great. Whenever somebody is discussing participant observation, he must refer to Malinowski. Wodenslaw Kaspar Malinowski is a very, very important name in that. But I don't think that there is any others are there. Brian Wilson, a very important contributor in religion. Then this Dean Martin, Brian Wilson referred to them. Dean Martin referred to them. And then this Anthony Giddens referred to them. Giddens is a man who is still alive, and he has extensively studied two things. One is fundamentalism and another is revivalism. It was his disciples, Kaplan, who came to India and he studied Sikh fundamentals. Kaplan is a student of Anthony Giddens, and he studied Sikh fundamentalism. He studied the Sikh fundamentalism. Many of the Sikhs were very angry that there is no fundamentalism in Sikhism, but why he is saying that the Sikhs are fundamentalist? There is fundamentalism among the Sikhs, nothing. When we discuss it, we'll be discussing it. Now, so with all respect to Radcliffe Brown, with all respect to Malinowski, we should not refer to Malinowski, we should not refer to Brown as far as discussion of religion is concerned. And in very often in sociology also, they are since anthropologists. Doyens of anthropology, they are the giants of anthropology. Now, as far as kinship is concerned, only four things. Discuss and read four things. One is regional variation of what? Of kinship. This is a very regular question. I don't know what is the fascination of UPSC with this. Every alternate year they ask questions. South Indian kinship, North Indian kinship, the regional variation of kinship, but you have to read it. And be very particular as to what is the concept of kinship. Remember that kinship is defined by culture. Defined by culture. It is not defined by biology. It is not defined by economy. It is defined by culture. Who will be your relation? Which relation is more important? In South India, the maternal uncle is the most important man. In North India, the paternal uncle is much more important than the maternal uncle. They do have very abusive relations. Tum kya bolega and tum kya bolega. So this is simply the imminence of blood relationship and the imminence of sex relationship. Clear? The second question is, as far as this household, again I don't know what is the fascination. Families, household dimensions. This is a book by M.S. Gore, Household Dimensions of Family. Probably you have heard the name of Gore Sahib, a very, very diligent, and A.M. Shah, again very important sociologist. Remember these Indian sociologists. They were first generation sociologists. First generation means Gore Sahib, Srinivas, M.S. Gore, our man, this A.M. Shah, now dead, or even that study or man from Baroda, family in Mahua. Who has studied this family in Mahua? It's a very, very popular question as far as family is concerned. He's always asked, family in Mahua. Who said that the joint family exists in our mind, not in the structural reality? Who was that man? No. Not Sa. Are Gujarati man from Baroda, he has studied on scheduled caste, he has studied the Mahua is a village in Gujarat, at that time Saurashtra, at his time the state was not divided. Remember, but this is a question. The third question as far as the current situation of family and marriage. What is this current situation? And fourth is live-in relations, because they have asked once about live-in relations. These are the things. No other questions are asked in family in Kishu. They don't ask anything. Now, as far as this social change is a part, there also only three things. Number one, I don't know why they have Marx, Sorokin and Ogburn. Marx, Sorokin and Ogburn. They ask the theory of Marx, they ask the theory of Sorokin, they ask the theory of Ogburn. So Ogburn is a famous man about cultural lag. He gave the concept of cultural lag, but not an important sociologist. The second thing about sociology is, they very often ask, that the factors of change, that means technology, culture, these are the, and the third thing is models. You might be surprised why I am saying models. Question is on models of development. There are only three models. One is the socialist, the second is modernization or capitalist, and the third is mixed economy, what we adopted in India. Mixed economy. India had been a poor country. Still today, we are not very rich. Although we are the sixth largest economy of the world. First is US, second is this China, the third is Japan, the fourth is Germany, the fifth is England, and the sixth is, earlier it was France, now it is India. So, but despite that, the per capita income in India is very low because the population is very large. Now, what we say that in this model, there is a question on dependency. This is a very popular question. Raoul Prebisch, the man who gave the theory of this dependency, and André Gunder Frank, the German sociologist who did his PhD on Latin America. He's a sociologist, and he did his PhD. He laid the ground for this concept of dependency. What has happened that the Latin American countries followed the capitalist path, and they were subjected to crisis. That is the reason that they rejected this, and they said, because of this path, we have become dependent on these people. This is the reason. Now, there is one part. André Gunder Frank. This is the man. You are referring to him or someone else? André Gunder Frank did his PhD on Latin America. He laid the ground for this dependency theory. He said that this path is not correct. he gave the concept of metropolitan capital, and he just engaged in a long term debate with a Pierre von Dier, a Dutch sociologist settled in America. What Dier said, that functionalism and conflict theory may come together. They are very similar. Frank said, no, they cannot come together. They are very different from one another. Clear? Now, my advice is, sincere advice is, that no matter how difficult it is for you, but you prepare very sincerely the topic of social research. You have to prepare. And because other people are not very serious about it and they find it very difficult. But number one is that you go for the principles of scientific method. These principles are objectivity. You add here value, neutrality. Then you do validity, then you do reliability. These are the principles of scientific method. Why we are saying principles? Because scientific method is based on the assumption that you should be objective, you should be value neutral, you should be valid, you should be reliable. Clear? Now, as far as the different perspectives on method are concerned, there are three perspectives. What is? One is positivism. So, the father of positivism is our August Comte. He said about now this positivism is the exact method of the natural sciences. This positivism and non-positivism, that is the interpretative, then there is quantitative and qualitative. These are quantitative and qualitative. These are the perspective, the approaches to the methodology of sociology. You have to do this. One is positivism, then this non-positivism, then this quantitative, then this qualitative. These are the questions you are very often asked. The second, then third thing is, the methods of sociology. The methods are four. One is empirical method. Empirical method. Part of positivity. The second is it's called interpretative method. More very frequently, this interpretative method means Verstehen. This is the German word which is very regularly asked. Verstehen is the German word which is very regularly asked. Then the third method is comparative method, and the fourth method is the historical method. In 2015, the question was on historical method. This is a question. So these are the four methods. Now, then there is the questions on two things. One is variable, they very often ask, and the second is nature of interpretation or mode of interpretation. Then technique of data collection. Now here this interpretation means two things, that how you just go on. One is hypothesis and another is sample. Hypothesis and sample. Last year the question was on sample, that what is sampling and that all that kind of thing. So in this data collection they generally ask on participant observation. Not more than that. You remember participant observation, the plus points of participant observation, but you have to give who were the good participant observers. In that you must refer to Malinowski, you must refer to A.F. White. A.F. White was the man who studied the Chicago Jewish colony and wrote the book Street Corner Society on the basis of that study. And so you will refer, you will give examples. Even our Andre Bete, he lived there in Sripuram for 9 months. His study is a participant observation. But Srinivasa's study of Ramapura is not a participant, it is a non-participant observation. It's a study based on non-participant observation. Because Ramapura is a village which is 26 kilometers away the town of Bangalore where Srinivas lived. So he every week went to, sometimes he stayed there for 1 or 2 days. But since he did not stay for a long time, because participant observation has 3 criteria. Live together, sleep together and eat together. Live together, sleep together and eat together. This is the criteria of participant
observation.
Yeah, he derived the concept of dominant caste from that village study itself. In fact, there are allegations on Srinivas, people object to it, that where from the dominant caste concept came. It was Evans Pritchard, again an anthropologist, Evans Pritchard, who studied the Nuer tribe of Sudan. Nuer tribe of Sudan. What was the word he used? Dominant clan. So, P.M. Kolenda, a Canadian scholar, but probably the most important expert on family. She studied family in 6 places of India. Pauline Mahar Kolenda, P.M. Kolenda. She said that Srinivas has taken this concept, dominant caste, from the concept of dominant clan. But his concept is very good, his concept is very effective, as his concept is popular. The concept is right, no matter from wherever he took it. But he found that in Ramapura village, Brahmins are no longer powerful. It is the Okkaliga caste who have become powerful there, and they have become the dominant caste. The concept is very correct, the concept is very effective. But I told you the story which is said that the dominant caste concept was adopted from this concept of a dominant clan. Now, as far as the first paper is concerned, only one thing now remains. What is that? Thinkers. You very often either fear thinkers or you give too much importance to thinkers. Actually, neither the thinker should be feared or nor the thinker should be given too much importance. Without thinker, can there be any sociology? No. In every question of yours, there is a relevance of theory. Without this thinker, you cannot have any sociological concept. So naturally, what you do is that you don't try to single them out. You just go on regularly reading about historical materialism, mode of production, class, class struggle, alienation. So, as far as Marx is concerned, these are the important concepts. What this I said, number one is historical materialism, the basic theory. The number two is mode of production. Number three is class. Number four is class struggle. And number five is alienation. Alienation. First is historical materialism, second is mode of production, the third is class, the fourth is class struggle, and the fifth is alienation. Clear? Now, the important thing in thinker is, very often you do not do it, always compare in between these three scholars, Marx, Weber and Durkheim, not Parson. You have to compare. What you do? Division of labor, write about Durkheim, but write about Marx and write about Weber also. You will say, sir, we don't find any material on division of labor as far as this Weber is concerned. At least we have tried in our study material to go along with the examination. Whatever is asked, we have tried to collect and we have tried to pinpoint that. Because Marx is a very stupendous scholar. We are not concerned everything about Marx. But definitely we are concerned with the comparison of Marx. So alienation of Marx and anomy of Durkheim. Anomy of Durkheim. That can always, that there is a comparison. So as far as Weber is concerned, you will be studying social action. Number two, this capitalism and Protestant religion, Number three, his concept of ideal type and verse 10. Number four, his power, class and status. So this is, you have to be very clear as to what power is, what class is, what status. Weber himself, Weber has written two things about India. Remember, there is a book on religions of India, 320 pages. In that book, he has discussed three religions. Number one, Hinduism. Number two, Jainism. Number three, Buddhism. Buddhism, in religion of China, there is discussion of Buddhism. Religion of China is also, more than 380 pages in religion of China is there, because he has referred to four things there. One is Buddhism, another is Shintoism, another is Confucius, another is Laozi. These are the four things in religion of China, published in 1960. He discusses these four things, old religions. Now, as far as Durkheim is concerned, the emphasis is on three things. One is method, this social fact. Number two is religion, and number three is division of labor. But remember, you have to attempt a comparison between all these three thinkers. This is nowhere written, but this has to be done. You must do it, because now the two sociologists of America, Parsons and Merton, in Parsons, what we study? Number one, social system. Number two, so not that important. Parsons' social action has not come very often. Yes, his what comes? The requisites of social system. That functional, in 2016 the question was on this. They wrote on this. This is the agile model. Functional problem referred to the agile model. Now, there is another thing to him, that some of he studied last year. The question was university as an example of subsystem or example of system. This is his own essay, Parsons' own essay. So very often you are asked on that. There is one more topic. This is part of this equilibrium. The university as a social system. University, this is an essay of Parsons. Different, and last year they asked it. Family as a social system can be asked. So the church as a social system can be asked. So, but you'll have to simply write two things. Number one, what are the requisites of a social system? It is not agile. Equilibrium is a requisite. Equilibrium is a requisite. Organization is a requisite. So these are the things which are required for a social system. Without them, a social system cannot exist. how equilibrium is established by socialization and social control. These are the two processes which maintain equilibrium. Social control. Socialization and social control are the two principal processes through which or by which equilibrium is maintained. This is the question generally, how equilibrium is maintained, you have to write that. So, then is our great Merton. Merton is popular, he should be popular. His three aspects, the functions and dysfunctions. Number two, his reference group. And as far as Merton's concept of this modern society, how he has criticized religion, he has criticized everything. So these are the problems of modern society. One, sometimes this aspect, sometimes that aspect, that is asked from modern society. One is the functional things, how the traffic police is doing something. So he is doing a function. So in this function, there are two very important parts, manifest and latent. You should write in your copies what latent is and what manifest is. Latent is not intended, manifest is intended. Latent is not recognized, manifest is recognized. These are the things. Only one person is now left, and that is George Herbert Mead. The very special thing about Mead was that he never wrote a book. He never wrote a book. He wrote some essays. It was his students, particularly Abdulwahid Thomas, this Rothman, these are the people who wrote his book. Bloomer, Herbert Bloomer was a man, was his student. They wrote three books for him. Mind, Self and Society, The Philosophy of the Present and The Philosophy of the Act. These are the three. It's a very typical of Mills. He was a teacher of philosophy in Chicago University. He is very famous as a psychologist. Anselm Vost, Anselm wrote a book on the social psychology of Mead. And he taught, he is discussed most in sociology. And famous and founder of the modern interactionist or the modern symbolic interactions school. Now, Mead has only two questions. Number one, that society and the individual are twins or twin born. They are, the individual society reflect the two sides of the same coin. In this question is asked, how self develops, how individual develops. Remember that Mead was very seriously influenced by Freud, Sigmund Freud. So the concept of pride, id, ego, and super ego have been just reflected by the concept of I, me, and he. I, me, and he are the concept of need. Wherefrom they are inspired? By id, by ego, and by super. Clear? So, the second question would be on symbolic interaction. Symbolic interaction would be the second question. Clear? Any doubts? So, this is actually the syllabus apart. The mode of the questions are this. Coming to the in this first paper, have you got any questions? Have you got? Oh, you are both are experienced people, and so you have been appearing in the exams. So, what are your problems in the first paper? Any problem in the first paper?
Generally, they ask dynamic properties like that you have asked gender, even port and dimension, modern world.
No, they're not. They're the easiest questions.
No, sir, you can write, but the problem is citing the thinkers here. How we can put the thinkers?
Yes, definitely. As far as this dynamic question, according to him, there may change. What change has happened? That gender earlier was not a part of the social stratification. Now it has become part of. So, naturally, when you discuss this, so as we said, analyst was the man, the woman, or this lady, Julia Kristeva, or this lady, Dean Martin, that analyst, we just call it analyst, Anasus Oakley, he is called very often in America as analyst. So this, these ladies, she should be referred to. That it is she, or it is, there was a question on this feminization of poverty. Feminization of poverty was a question in sociology. 2016. Actually, I said three things are important. One is study, another is reference, and the third is example. So, his problem is how to relate the thinkers with dynamic, change-oriented questions. Since you have not studied in that vein, probably in our discussion also, we'll be always referring to that, and we'll be always giving examples. Don't give any example which is in the book. Give your own example, but from the public sphere. Your own individual experience should not be said. Something which has come in the newspapers, something which has been referred to in the television, in the media, in any example that should be given. Now, to find out an example becomes difficult when you do not understand a concept. If you understand the concept, for example, the concept of verse 10, you have simply heard it, you have not understood it. Verse 10 is a simple thing. interpretation. What is this interpretation? Because you have got your own idea, your interpretation. I have got my own idea, this is my interpretation. So this interpretative interpretation is done by asking people what they think about different phenomena or a particular phenomena. On the basis of their interpretation, then the sociologist does his own interpretation. There should not be any values in that interpretation. It has to be value neutral. As far as the selection of the problem is concerned, selection of the topic is concerned, that depends on your choice. So that is value relevant. Value relevant. If you understand the concept, you can definitely give the example. If you do not understand the concept, probably it would become difficult for you to give an example. Now, actually, in the dynamic questions, what you are saying, that we know about the pioneers, but we do not know about the modern. Enocle is alive. Enocle is alive. Satish Deshpande.
We don't know, sir. We are unaware of them because they are not mentioned in any of the books which we read.
Richard is a book of thinkers, yeah.
Richard, sociological, Indian sociological. Also, testing the state and nation with some examples.
Here, how it is difficult? The Palestinians are a nation. It's not a state. You have you quote Weber. What is the need of quoting? You quote the modern sociologists, like those who are now living. His problem is right. He said, we have not heard about them because you have not been told about them or you have not read about them. But as far as my discussions are concerned, we'll be always talking about A.M. Shah or this, because without discussing those people, I am not a sociologist. And so my opinion and my ideas do not hold valid. But those people who have done some study, Satish Pandey, or this Patel, or this the lady, Surinder Jodhka. Surinder Jodhka has to be referred in any discussion of caste. He has written a book published by Oxford, because caste is also a dynamic thing. You know and you remember, you just have an idea that what Ghures have said about caste is no longer valid. Caste is not a system. No longer it is a system. It has become an unit. It has become an identity and consciousness. But it is very important. Bethe said that it has become an identity and consciousness in 1995 in his lecture as the president of Indian Sociology Association. But our Srinivas Sahib, he died in 1999, and in 1998 he said, wrote an essay, gave a speech, Obituary of the Caste System. What he means, that caste as a system is no longer existing, but caste is very powerful. It's not part of the system, but it is the mode of social division in India. So, in fact, the difficulty is that since you do not have the material, but basic thing is that you understand the current, you understand what caste is, what caste today is.
Give us a list of relevant modern second or third generation. I can quote
that. Yeah, I know. Actually, in our course of...
You have what the quote by these classes, okay. But the modern people, they haven't provided well. You don't know actually.
Most of the classes only marks better, all this challenge.
In fact, I report 9 notes, all are repeated again and again, the same kind of thing.
But you have learned that...
And in fact, the note, like Surendra Jodhata, they are hardly, you know, depicted in the
I have first time I'm hearing, sir.
I actually, that's not, actually Jodhka wrote a book on caste. The title of the book is Caste. It has been published by Oxford University Press. Why he wrote it? Because he refers to the whole argument of G.S. Ghure. Ghure said a caste system has 6 characteristics. One is division of labor. Another is its this hierarchy, another is its this rigidity, another is this endogamy, marriage within the caste, another is the restrictions on food and drink, another is untouchability. These are the things, Now, Jodhka said that no longer these features are sufficient to explain the phenomena of caste. You are asked questions. Has caste declined? Has caste disintegrated? Or it has simply changed? This is a statement of Surendra Jodhka. So, no, then I don't think that would be something which can serve you purpose, because this can have a meaning when you discuss the questions and we refer to, because or supposing I give a list of the village studies.
No, sir, suppose the question is revolution is now very dynamic today. Okay, let's forget this.
Yes, this is a dynamic question. That is a dynamic question.
Now, revolution, although in notes some things have been mentioned, but latest study, there is no latest study, then how can you quote anybody in
it? Ah, Baba, as far as revolution is concerned, you can quote Paul Sweezy, but now dead. Paul Sweezy was an American sociologist of German origin. At least you can quote Ralph Dahrendorf, because Dahrendorf, now dead, very famous third generation.
Kaun
se? No, but even in the first paper, you must write about the modern thinkers. Many names have been given by Harlan Boss, but now there is no time for Harlan Boss. But in our discussions,
in the
so we can refer to those things, those thinkers, in the because any list would be meaningless. Because that would be out of context. So you can understand it and you can remember it only when we just discuss it in the context of particular periods or particular discussions. As far as the second paper is concerned, come to the second paper. I have already told you something. Number one is the conception of India. I have added one more. One is Ghure. There is a word Indology which is very often misused, and this is very often rather abused. Indology was given by Max Müller.
this was. So some people have said that this man, Louis Dumont, was an Indologist. No, never write it. Louis Dumont, you have to study him. He was now dead, died of a very long life, 1991 or 90, Louis Dumont died. He was a French, but studied more in England. He was a scholar of Sanskrit. It's a great thing. But he was no Indologist. That's a popular confusion in Delhi. I don't know why. And Indology is a thing where we eulogize, admire, praise Indian society, Indian culture, Indian civilization. Louis Dumont was almost abusive of Indian culture. The hierarchical, the group based, all this backwards. Compared to India, the Western society is very, very important, because there is in the Western society egalitarianism, there is individualism, there is freedom to go up. How he can be an Indologist? Indology praises Sanskrit language as the oldest organized language, praises the Aryans. Max Müller said that these Europeans are Indo-Europeans. The Iranians are Indo-Iranians. Indians are the Indo-Aryans. So naturally...
So the difference between culturologist and Indologist is only to appreciation.
No, not appreciation, not appreciation. There are five things. Number one, the Aryan race is the supreme race of the world. They have the duty to unite the world under their leadership.
This is also appreciation.
This is not an appreciation of only India, but the whole Aryan group, the whole...
Largely, both Indologists and culturologists study their own culture only.
No. The culturologists have a different agenda. Weber is a culturologist, Parsons is a culturologist, in the sense they give importance to culture. You remember, there are three resources, three capacities, three things which makes you important. How you become important from a non-important person, when you have got three things, or either of the three things, or two things. One is wealth, money, it's a resource. The second is power, and the third is culture. So, you know, and the name of a particular person, although a Marxist, but now dead, 2013 died, Pierre Bourdieu. So you have heard his name, Bourdieu's name, Pierre Bourdieu. Child is good, but his more famous concept is cultural capital. He is the father of the concept of cultural capital. He was a French, he studied in Algeria, Al-Salam village, and he said that if you want to sing, if you want to give speeches, if you want to just have the capacity to write very good pieces, then you have the cultural capital. He said there are four types of capital. One is the economic capital, you have got the wealth. Other is the political capital, you have influence over so many people. The third is the cultural capital, you know speaking, you know writing, you know singing, you know, dancing. Then there is the social capital. What does it mean? You have the contact with very important persons. You say, "Are, how you can say, sir, is anything? I go to Modi ji every fortnight." Makes you important. You have the social capital. These four capitals are interrelated, but they are separate and they have autonomous existence. Now, what he was saying, that culturologist is one who gives more importance to the capital of culture. But Indologist is not that. The capital of culture. What Parson says, we have the relationship because the rule is of that type. What Weber says, that culture guides our action, culture guides our values. Why capitalism? Because of Protestant religion. It has given birth to capitalism. So, no direct relationship is there, but this has facilitated the rise of capitalism. What is Protestantism? It is a cultural thing. So, naturally, don't try to equate Indology and culture. Indology is an ideology. Culture is not an ideology. Culture simply says that cultural elements are more important than economic elements. In India, people say, "Arey, आपका पैसा लोग छीन सकते हैं, आपका पावर जा सकता है, where your vidya will go, you ingrain it." ऐसा, this is said very often. you won't lose your this intellect. So intellect is a cultural resource. But Indology and culturalology are two different things, entirely different. Now it is clear. So as far as this second paper is concerned, the first topic is the conception of India. There are four. In the syllabus, there are only three. The Desai, and this Marxism, Srinivas, is structure and function, and I have added one more, Bethe. Weber's conception. Bethe is the only Weberian in Indian sociology. I don't know why people are not that much influenced. In India, functionalism is popular like fire. Everybody is a functionalist. The first generation sociologist, Ghure, Srinivas, Gore, this man Dubey, Iravati Karve. So probably you have heard everybody's name. These are the first generation sociologists. The second generation sociologists, like our Shah is first generation, but this man Andre Bethe, Srinivas is first generation because they both worked in Delhi University. Srinivas was the professor and Bethe was the reader. But as far as this gap is concerned, in this Bethe generation, there have been many sociologists. For example, that Patel is there, Gujarat sociologist Ghanshyam Shah is there. You have probably heard about the summary of social movements written by Ghanshyam Shah. Social movement summary or social movement evaluation has been done by him. So this conception Indology is asked sometime in the second paper. Sometime functional view of Srinivas is asked. But till date, Weber has not been asked, Bethe has not been asked. Bethe has been asked in the context of caste. Context of caste. The second topic is the impact of British rule in India or on India. One is British rule, one is Desai, modern social backgrounds of Indian nationalism. Alternate year this is asked. And the second is Yogen Singh or Y Singh, as popularly he is known, the modernization of Indian tradition. Modernization. Even this Yogen Singh is a second generation sociologist of India. Just like Bethe, he is a second generation sociologist of India. Then M.S. Rao was a second generation sociologist. Probably have heard about M.S. Rao. You cannot think of urbanization study in India without a reference to M.S. Rao. He has written a book, India's Urban Future, an edited book, a very good book that way. He is also now dead. M.S. Rao said that he has studied Delhi. So he said that Delhi cannot sustain without the Biharis or without the outsiders. So all those works are done by these people. Now, as far as this third topic, caste is concerned, they have referred in this. One is Ghure, another is Louis Dumont, Homo Hierarchus. Probably nobody attracted so much of criticism as Dumont attracted in India. So R.S. Khare, B.R. Chauhan, all these sociologists, then this Yogesh Atal, these are all second generation sociologists. Yogesh Atal is there, he has written about social change. He was the advisor of UNESCO in South Asia. then this man from Pune, they all are second generation. The third in this is Srinivas, and the fourth is Bethe. This is as far as caste is concerned, you will have a question on caste, no matter whatever you do. But in fact, what I find in Delhi, that they do not have a real conception of what Dumont says or what Bethe says. They discuss it, but I don't know, because Bethe has undergone a change. Bethe said in the vein of Weber that caste is a status group. Bethe studied Tamil Nadu's Sripuram village. Again in 1968 he visited. He first went to Sripuram in 1959. The book was published in 1963. But again he visited Tamil Nadu. And he said caste is much more than a status quo. So what he says, that caste has a political dimension, caste has a social dimension, caste has an economic dimension, and caste also has cultural dimensions. Very many people say, what is in a name? It was Bethe who said, in India, everything lies in a name. If you have a Dalit title, you are disparaged. If you have got a Brahmin title, upper caste title, you are praised. It was his words. So that was, that has to be referred, that has to be taken into consideration. As far as Dumont is concerned, Dumont's views are more ideological than sociology. But his formulations, that it is purity and pollution, and it is hierarchy and holism, those are the four central principles. There are many admirers of Louis Dumont in India. T.N. Madan, secondary sociologist. Yogen Singh, he praised Louis Dumont, and Yogen Singh said that Indian society is characterized by four attributes. One is holism, importance of group. Holism means importance of group. Hierarchy, segmental division. Then this all history, no mention of history. And the fourth is renunciation. Indian people did not have any history tradition. Many people just object to this, no, we had Puran, we had all the Purans, Upanishads, all the reference are there. No. Probably the first book of history in India was Raj Tarangini by Kalhan. Raj Tarangini by 14th century text. So we started writing history from 14th century onwards. This is a feature of Indian society and culture according to Yogen Singh. We do not care for history. This is the creation of the God, and God would take the, this creation into consideration, and he will follow all this. Naturally, as far as this renunciation is concerned, what does it mean? We have got four ashrams: Brahmacharya, Grahastha, this Vanprastha, and then Sannyas and Vanprastha. That is last, yes. And this, so what we say that Vanprastha to just go towards this one, leaving all those worldly things. Sannyas, you totally retire from worldly activities. What is this? This is renunciation. When the mother-in-law has become very old, the daughter-in-law wants that the keys should be transferred to her. This is something which is... Now, Bethe said that as far as Islam is concerned, Islam is very different from Hinduism, in the sense that Hinduism is based on holism, Islam is based on individualism. Every time it is said that you will be responsible for your own deeds, nobody, nor your father, nor your mother, nor your brother, nor your friend, nobody is going to help you in the final judgment. Second, this thing, Islam, is egalitarian. Eat together, pray together, do together, all these things. The third is, there is sense of history. And the fourth is, there is no renunciation. You can work up to the last breath of your life. These are the things. So, naturally, as far as Khan.
You have just mentioned this. Yogendra Singh said, India doesn't have history.
No, he does not say. He says, Indian society and culture has an attribute that this society does not give credence to history.
Okay. So,
It is an ideology.
It's an ideology.
Yeah. Indology is an ideology, it is not me who is saying this, but I think whoever has commented on it.
You can write in answer to the Indology
ideology. Yeah, 100%. This is the ideological view of Indian society, seeing this is not a theory, this is not a perspective, this is only an ideology, a particular specs through which we see Indian society. That's it. I think even that B.K. Nagla, who has written a book, a third class book on Indian sociologists, he is a retired person, so he requested for almost 3 years me that I should cooperate with him. I said, sir, you are very senior and I do have a very different orientation than what you have. He is a Brahmin by caste, Managlaji, and he is not very well read. That's what I felt, because he also came to JNU. I am also a regular visitor to JNU for the last 10 years. And so, more than 10 years. So naturally, I appreciate the study of those students. I fear them, because they are very, very, those who have studied many books, who have not studied that much. They have been a culture of studying things. So now, as far as this second paper is concerned, there is a topic on this class also, that not only caste but classes also. There are four things. Number one, what is the class division of India? Number two, that what is the middle class? Number three, class in industry. And number four, class in agriculture. Class in agriculture. In this context, as far as India is concerned, you have to take into consideration the views of Bethe. There have been twice questions in UPSC that discuss the view of class according to Andre Bethe. He has taken the Weberian view that class is a category of people. That category is determined and decided by market situation. How this market situation decides? The assets are distributed among people. One has this, one has that, this much of money, this much of power, this much of prestige. So, on the basis of the evaluation in the market, what is this evaluation in the market? Arey Baba, there is a marriage market also. The grooms have different importance in different societies. In Bihar, Uttar Pradesh, Odisha, Maharashtra, even Andhra Pradesh, the IAS is a god. What is the position in Gujarat? No. IAS is on the fifth position. A servant. IAS is supposed to be a servant in Gujarat. So naturally, they give more importance. So this is the marriage market. In the market as such, different assets are differently associated. On the basis of this, Weber also said five classes. Bethe also said five classes. Weber also said every class has a different life chance. Bethe also said that every class has a different life chance. Life chance means you have got the different amenities. You have got a different amenities, you have got the different. Now, this is another topic you have to study and you have to do in the second period. Now, as far as this second paper is concerned, after that, again you have to go for family and kinship. The same thing as we said in the first paper, the regional variations of India, household dimensions of Indian family. So in that respect, you always just give reference to the old studies. There are some very famous studies. For example, I said Madan is there, T.N. Madan's study is there. The second is K.M. Kapadia's study is there. Third is Iravati Karve's study is there. Now, probably you have heard about her, Patricia Oberoi. No. She is the Oberoi, or sometime it is, she is written as this Oberoi. So she is alive, she is a second generation sociologist. She has criticized Karve. She has criticized even this Kapadia. Kapadia studied family in Navsari, Maharashtra. This Madan studied Jammu Kashmir family. And Iravati ji studied Maharashtra, Konkan region families. So naturally, even Desai has written about family. This the man I was trying to refer to you, but he could not remember him. I.P. Desai. I.P. Desai is the man who has studied family in Mahua. Family in Mahua. He is a first generation sociologist. Now dead. I.P. Desai said, joint family exists in our minds, not in the real empirical field. It was his view. Now this lady, Patricia Oberoi, has also written Kinship and Family in India. Kinship and Family in India. Then come down to this Indian politics. Three things are very important. One is political elite. Second is political parties. And the third is pressure group. Pressure group. Elite, party and pressure group. Political elite of India, political parties of India and pressure groups in India. Now in the context of this politics, probably they can relate questions on two things. Backward castes and Dalit castes. On Dalits, they ask two things, identity, and the second thing is struggle. Identity and struggle. So you have to prepare questions on Dalits because they will be there. They will be there, and these questions will be asked. No matter what happens, you will have a question on Dalit. Now, as far as this religion is concerned, there are two aspects they very often ask. One is pluralism. One is pluralism, different practices of religion. What does it mean? Animism, animatism, monism, pluralism. Monism means one God, pluralism means multiple gods. So, the second thing is that this religiosity and this revivalism are asked in different ways. Religiosity means Indian society gives too much importance to religiosity. They cannot conceive of a group, they cannot conceive of an individual who does not have religion or who does not follow a religion. So, Madan was right. India is a religious society. India is a religious society where religion is given utmost importance. In that context, you have to be concerned about Ashish Nandi. You have heard his name? Ashish Nandi. Nandi is a second generation sociologist, but he has more written on psychology, more written on this political science and politics. In 1984, he wrote an article in the journal Seminar, Anti-Secular Manifesto, and he said, secularism is a weak ideology for India. That was a question in UPSC, second paper. Read the questions. Secularism is a weak ideology for India. Who said? Ashish Nandi said it. Who supported? T.N. Madan supported it. Yes, secularism is not for India. That's a Western concept. This is an alien concept. This cannot happen in India. Shashi Tharoor says something different. And Shashi Tharoor is no sociologist that way, but he is a scholar. Shashi Tharoor, other than a Congress leader, Shashi Tharoor has written good books, very scholarly books that way. And he has definitely written them in a very cogent style. And we, rather than quoting Shashi Tharoor, we should emphasize on Nandi, we should emphasize on T.N. Madan. Without a reference to Nandi, Indian secularism cannot be discussed. Now, there is one popular topic which is very often asked, that is village. So, again, four questions. One is, two were important, the idea of Indian village. Second is, the village studies. The third is, changes in village studies. And the fourth is, rural crisis. The fourth is rural crisis. Last year there was a question on village studies. So remember all these Srinivasan, these have done village study. 1950 to 70, 20 years. Scarlett Easton, B.S. Cole, then this Hosselis, all these people studied different Indian villages. Even our Mandelbaum studied a Kerala village and then Maharashtra village. So Indian, other than the Indian scholar, Ramkrishna Mukherjee, probably have heard the name, no. Ramkrishna Mukherjee, six villages of Bengal. Ramkrishna Mukherjee is also a second generation sociologist, but died. He died in 2015. He has written six villages of Bengal, and the second book is very famous, Rise and Fall of East India Company. Rise and Fall of East India Company. So, by this, then what we see that these are the things about village. In this idea of Indian village, probably you do not know the changes. The village in contemporary India before independence was a different entity. What was that? It was a semi-feudal village. Yeah. But the British conception is wrong. Autonomous, independent, separate, a republic. This was something. Charles Metcalf was a British East India Company official. In 1828, in answer to a question in British House of Commons, he prepared the answer. And that answer contained these things. But the tragedy is that the Britishers, probably you have heard the name of Henry Mann, the very famous writer of ancient law. He also wrote a book, The Village Communities of the East and the West. He repeated the same thing in 1860. The thing which was said in 1828, he repeated the same thing. That was a mistake, and that's a mistake. village studies were started by historians in India, but Srinivas was one of the earliest persons in sociology who went to a village on the advice of his teacher to the Coorg areas in 1942 itself, and on the basis of that he wrote Religion and Societies Among the Coorgs of South India. This is his book. So as far as social change in India is concerned, this social transformation and this social change has three aspects. One is the programs of development, So there will be, for example, even CDP can be asked. Sometimes they ask this trisem, but those things have become very old. Now there is Rurban Mission, and they can ask questions on Rurban Mission. Rurban Mission. This, yeah, this is a us. This sectoral. Yes, villages, by making the clusters of the villages, and the cluster should be there. But we are not concerned with the program. We are concerned with the perspective of sociology in that program. What this perspective is, as I said, any program, we discuss the social fact. Who are supporting it? We discuss the major structures, how these major structures would be affecting this program. We just discuss what is the current context of this program. Why this program is being brought right now? Only two lines. And the So the fourth is that we just are concerned with what kind of actions. For example, there was Manrega, and Manrega was thrice asked in sociology. We are not concerned with this is the program, this is the allocation. No. Who are the groups who are being benefited by Manrega? Who are the groups who are trying to provide the benefits? It was sociological advice that the Manrega money, Manrega is continuing, and this money is being given to the beneficiaries through the banks. Earlier this was given through the block offices or block development offices. So naturally, the second part of it, this social change in India, is that what are the models? What we are, this planning and this Niti Aayog, what's the difference as far as sociology is concerned, and how we can just distinguish them on the basis of sociological interpretations? This is a concern. So naturally, and the third thing is the problems of change. The problems of change. Rural conflict, agrarian crisis, farmer movement, these all things, these are problems. These are happening because the social change programs are creating such things. For example, they may ask feminization of agriculture. They are asked, why this feminization of agriculture is happening? This is part of the tension thing. Feminization of agriculture means, this is not a good word, this is a bad word. Why bad? Because this refers to a problem where women are forced to do the act of agriculture. They do not do on their own. Since men have migrated to the urban areas, she is left with no other choice but to do the agriculture. So agriculture suffers, and the woman is forced to do this. So agriculture production falls. That's the one person said, probably you have heard about Carol Upadhyay. Carol Upadhyay, a third generation sociologist who criticized Ghure as Hindu nationalist sociologist. Hindu nationalist sociologist Carol Upadhyay. She also said, and she also studied the changes and the crises of agriculture. The changes and the crises of agriculture. In this part, we'll also have three questions. One is land question and land reform. The second is Green Revolution, and the third is Second Green Revolution. The third is, so on all the three you'll have questions. See the old questions and then you'll find that the questions are there. Land question, with that land reform was there. Green revolution is no means of land reform. It is something entirely different. Green revolution in sociological terms is the introduction of capitalism in agriculture. This commercialization was done by Cornwallis much earlier. That commercialization failed. That did not help agriculture. That created a crisis of agriculture. Cash crops were not started, but these food cereals, they declined, and that led to famines. Twice in his regime of 8 years, there were two famines at the time of Cornwallis. And the definite outcome of the deliberate commercialization of agriculture. This Green Revolution is not commercialization. This Green Revolution is a capitalism, full-scale capitalism in agriculture. The third is the need of a second Green Revolution. Everybody is saying that the second Green Revolution should occur. Still, it has not taken place. But probably it can be there within the next 5 years, the second Green Revolution. Clear? So you must write in a sociological perspective. Sometimes sociology marks are very, very high because they pick up the sociological perspective. Yeah.
Sociologically, you have to write sociology.
Yes.
So suppose there is a question of relevance or need of Niti Aayog. So I guess what not only. And how to write sociology.
This you think, what is Niti Aayog? The first two lines would be there, that Niti Aayog is a consultative public policy institution which studies and create the public policy, what would be the changes. Now, the second thing is question, right question. How this Niti Aayog can be studied in a sociological sense? Again, the question of social fact. Whose collective consciousness is this? Whose collective representation is this? It is the elite of India who has designed this. It is the
development.
Why not? Actually, you are thinking that sociology is not a science, rather it is an ideology. Sociology is science. give example. Arvind Pangadia himself now voluntarily gone out of this Niti Aayog. This man, this Bengali, no, there is a member. No, not the new. But there is another, this man who was just earlier an advisor to the Jharkhand government. He also said that Niti Aayog represents the view of the elite, not the view of the masses. This is for the masses, but this is by the elite. They themselves are seeing it. Actually, when we write about sociology, you write that second thing, macro structures. Niti Aayog has replaced planning commission because India's economy has sufficiently developed. Only one line. You write that today Indian capitalists are just trying to control foreign industries and they are investing in other countries. Earlier it was not the fact. Yeah. So this is something. Indian economy has grown. That is why the need of Niti Aayog is there. As far as the concern of society is concerned, Indian society was semi-feudal in 1950. Bethe says this, our this lady, this Balwinder Kaur, she said this, that this is, and this is a fact. Whether you accept it or do not accept it, it was a semi-feudal society. But by 1970, by 1975, India became a transitional society, a changing society, fast changing society, because of the changes produced by programs, because of the changes produced by the market, because of the changes produced by the elite. Market, elite, and development programs. So, this concern, Baker says, earlier the nature of American society was large agrarian structures. Before 1840, what kind of a society America was? Agrarian society. It became an industrial society only by the 1860s. Capitalist society only by the, it was much ahead than America and England in developing capitalism. England remained for a long time a mercantile country, not a capitalist country, but America became much earlier a capitalist country. So this is the concern of society. Today Indian society has become a modern capitalist society. That is why no longer the need of planning is there, rather the need of only public policy body is there. So Niti Aayog, only 2-3 lines you write. Indian society has changed and developed, it has become a modern society, so now planning is not required, rather policy guidelines are required. Then
sociologically thinking is we have to frame our answer in terms of macro, micro, great tradition, little tradition.
No, not great tradition, little tradition. How could just
I am largely saying social fact, macro structure,
this society concern, then this social action, and this lastly the social concern. Whose concern Niti R. Baba Akhil Skill India program. This is a program advised by this Niti Aayog. Urban Mission advised by the Niti Aayog. By this they are trying to develop India. By this they are trying to modernize India. Urban India has modernized. But as far as rural India is concerned, it has not modernized. So naturally, there is need of modernization of rural India as well. So what the need to, now you know, this social concern, Martha Nussbaum, it has been the concern of sociologists. David Harvey, a sociologist and economist of America, he says America has tremendously advanced, but American society has stagnated. Why? He says that we have not taken care of women. Still, American women are very, very lagging. Although we know that American woman has done extreme. Yes, yeah.
And sir, how to relate this question to social behavior?
Yeah, social action. You think that this Niti Aayog has the onerous responsibility to activate people, social action, activate people for this program.
So, the correct is that we have to frame on these 5 points.
No. Actually, then you'll become blind. You'll become mechanical. Yes, sociology is a dialectical and dynamic science. It's a dialectical and we want to see what kind of contradictions, what kind of, don't you think that the Dalit upper caste contradiction has increased? The backward upper caste contradiction has somewhat increased. This demand of reservation from the very powerful backward caste. This is nothing but this is a demand for power sharing. This is not for jobs. This is for power from the backward castes. So definitely, this is an answer. So don't be mechanical that macro structure is that. You have in mind and that you are right. Clear? Now, two things only are remaining. One is the our leaders. One is Gandhi. His untouchability and his views on democracy and his views on secularism. Probably in 2015, Ramchandar Guha's book, it's a good book. If you have got time, read it. Makers of Modern India. Although very lengthy, but it's a very good book. Makers of Modern India. So, all the three writers, Phule, radical peasant leader, Ambedkar, wise democrat, and this Gandhi in the context of Hind Swaraj, his political views. So, you remember that these questions, one is untouchability, second is his views on democracy, and third is views, sometimes it is possible that his views on industry may be asked. Gandhi did not want modern industries. He did not want factories. He wanted the village. He wanted the village handicraft and all such things. Now, as far as this man, second man is concerned, Phule. Views on backward caste, peasant question, education and women. Phule was a man from Mumbai, Maharashtra. belonged to this Pune. He was born in Pune, a gardener by caste, sufficiently rich. He had 30 acres of land given by the Peshwa, and his only duty was that every morning he will give the flowers, or he will just reach the flower to the Peshwa's house. He was a contractor and he was a member of Legislative Assembly of Bombay, nominated by the British. Now this man, not much educated, but he was very modern in the sense. He was a casteist, no doubt. He belonged to a backward caste. He was opposed to the Brahmins, and his movement is called as anti-Brahmin movement. But sufficiently, as far as women are concerned, it was fortunate that the Phules did not have any issues. Savitri Phule, his wife, and Phule, this Jyotiba Rao Dandokar Bhosle, Dandokar Phule, had no issues. That's why he took almost 300 women to his home. Those who had deserted, threw away by the families, upper caste families, because they were widows and they had become pregnant. They are thrown out of the home. He collected all those women and he gave them education. He gave them some kind of, his wife also gave them education. As far as the field of education is concerned, he said two things. Number one, there must be English education. He was very much influenced by the Christian missionary schools. And the second thing he said, that women must be educated along with men. Savitri Phule was the first woman teacher of India. Savitri Phule was the first, his wife. So this is clear that these are the questions on which. The third is Ambedkar. One, his views on caste, that was asked. And second, his views on untouchability. One is caste, and views of Ambedkar on the caste system, on the caste question. And second, his views related to untouchability. What he thought about the Dalits. The word Dalit, he used the English word depressed. Dalit is a translation of the word depressed. It's a translation of the word depressed. So naturally, when we say this, we also mean that these questions and these such questions would be there, and you have to. I think there is material, but you have to write it in sociological frame again. You will not be writing as a general knowledge, because even in general studies, Gandhi would be asked, Phule would be asked, Ambedkar would be asked. But you have to give there, after all, Ambedkar was a student of sociology. He studied sociology as one optional paper in Columbia University, and he did not had any training of this law in America. He got this law degree from England. He returned to India. After 5 years, again he went to England, and then he got from the money of Sahuji Maharaj, and then he got the degree of barrister at law. He became a successful lawyer, whereas Gandhiji was not a successful lawyer. This is a fact. The last is, as far as the second paper is concerned, social issues. Again, what I say, that you have to write, for example, Child Labor Act 2016. how you write? Not this is the act, this is the, no, we are not concerned. GS, not GS Lane. Sociological interpretation has to be there. Sociological interpretation has to be there. And this interpretation is that you will write opposed to the social activists. They are saying child labor should be totally banned. Sociology says no, this should not be banned. What would happen because of that? Many people would die. When the child labor goes for work, he goes on the consent of the parents. He helps the family income. There might be a demand on the part of the radical social activists to ban it. But if they ban it, where from those parents, poor parents, would eat? You will write that. The Child Act 2016 that way is more sociological sensitive than the earlier act was. Why? There are three things. Yeah, exemption. Number one, that the criteria of hazardous act has been changed. Second, that in the Child Labor Act, now it has been said that after schools, the child can go for labor. Number three, it has been said that if it is a family concern, then the child can work. If it's a family concern, then the child can work. So naturally, the Indian Forest Act, primarily designed to help the tribals, you'll write how far the tribes are going to be benefited from this exercise. The tribal, this Forest Right Act has been severely criticized by the sociologists. Why? Because there are many exemptions given to industry and trade in violation of this Forest Right Act. In the Forest Right Act, there is a compulsion. Unless and until the Gram Sabha has agreed to do this, no concern, no industry will be started. Clear? So this is, as far as this second paper or the whole sociology is concerned, but I think that you should change your writing method, the sociology perspective should be there. And also the second thing, that you have to add to the list of sociologists and go for, many people say, no, though, sir, I am subscribing to the this vision studies, and no need of that. Rather, if you take some journals, magazines, then, or if you take some good books in currently, then you can get all the studies. Need not write many studies in one essay, in one answer of 200 words. Never write more than three studies. Never write, and that study should be referred only in the context or only in two or three lines, not more. Don't write anything rubbish. Write exact material. So you say, sir, very often there are so many questions and we have to do that. So we have to write, sir, 10 notes and we have to write 9 questions. Out of those, 6 questions are 200 words and 3 questions are 150 words. You know how difficult it is. Every good thing is a difficult thing.